Kevin, welcome back to our decking series.
Yeah, thank you. Great to be here.
Yeah, no, good stuff. Well, earlier we did one segment on installation basics where we covered spanning and gapping, things like that. I thought we'd take it a step further, maybe in installation basics 2.0, and tackle the ongoing conversation about butt joints. I know we talked about ways to potentially avoid butt joints in the early planning and design, but if you have to do it or choose to do it, can you talk about the proper method of doing that as far as framing and so forth?
Yes, no, I'd love to. The first thing we want to do is, you know, make sure your deck surface is level. So you want to shave or shim these joists because you can't just put in a new joist and think everything's going to be level. So you have highs and lows. And with any kind of composite decking, we're going to follow any highs and lows out there. So really, most calls that I have gotten that my deck board is kind of dropping down or anything, it's because we have a high joist and a low joist. But you're going to want to make sure that's all level. And then you're going to want to add in another joist here or a nailer board. And really make sure you have that screw and that clip not sharing that joist because you can't hit that joist full on. So really need four clips.
That's a great point. So yeah, in our previous video where we talked about being an inch back from that joint going perpendicular and not being able to fasten at all on a single joist. So you could either plan up front and actually have double joists in your plan, you know, full height joist, or you could scab on another piece so you can accomplish that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And that's one of those things you can't really do after easily. So once your deck is all framed up and you actually got this right in the middle here, to correct that, you'd have to, after correcting it, you'd have to put one on both sides.
Yeah.
So that's where it's real important to do that up front.
That's a good point. And then, like you say, that whole idea of not sharing one clip, that's not not the best practice there.
No, it's just not enough holding power, and you can see how you know, small that shelf is. And if you try to share it, what could happen during expansion contraction is that it could actually just even pop off that clip.
Yeah.
And so that's where you get that.
Sure. Okay. Glad we covered that. The other one that it sounds like it's been around a long time as a best practice, but sort of new on my radar in the last years is the requirement to recut the ends of the boards.
Yeah.
I figured, well, a lot of it just gets cut anyway. It has to get cut to length based on your design. But if you somehow had a design that just fit the boards right off the stack, you still need to trim those ends for some reason.
Yes.
Could you talk about that, the why?
You know, they're all cut with a traveling saw coming down the extruder. So if you can imagine our product being extruded out and going down a traveling rollers
of some sort,
and then the saw follows it and cuts it.
Okay.
So earlier generations of that, they weren't really that accurate and not square because it's just cut while it's moving. So we'd have maybe 2 to 3 inches longer. So a 20-foot board would actually be 20 foot 2-3 inches.
Okay.
Today we're maybe 20 foot 1 inch or 20 foot 1/2 inch, but that's gotten a lot more accurate.
Okay.
But also, so one, you want to cut that end to square it and make sure it's all square.
Okay.
And two, the manufactured end here, you can see how rough it is here.
Oh yeah.
And then this other side is cut and you can look and see how smooth it is.
Oh, that's night and day.
Yeah. So it comes, when it's extruded out, it's a real hot temperature, and that's what you want to make sure that if there is wood fibers that are exposed and not fully encapsulated with wood, you want to make sure you cut that off. But once you do, it does, you know, reseal that end.
Yeah.
You don't need any treatment or any sealer at the end of our boards. It automatically does it. And that's the benefit of using the softer type of plastics too, your garbage bag, shrink film, and all that stuff.
Okay, interesting. Well, gosh, when we started talking about this and I started thinking about it more, I thought, all right, get this big pile of decking out in your driveway, you're dragging it around back, setting it up on my saw table, cutting one end, flipping the board around, cutting it, hopefully the exact right measurement on my deck that I need, taking it over there, placing it, and then trying to get that all lined up. And you know as well as I do, no matter how good you are, that is really hard. You stand back looking out your patio door and going, that's not as great.
Yeah.
So the light went on when you were talking about the pre-planning session earlier and the whole idea of the picture framing, the transition boards. Yeah. So I thought, well, gosh, all right. You lay the, say, just had a simple deck like this, and all of a sudden you just, you put a transition board in the middle, divide those things up, and you undersize your deck enough to where out at the end your boards can run long.
Yeah.
And you just chalk a few lines, make those cuts, you got straight and a lot less headache.
Yeah, and it also saves a lot of insulation time too. So yeah, you'd have the picture frame board and then a transitional board, and you can build those surfaces as two different decks even, because yeah, they're created their own surface. So yeah, really you'd build this deck first, yeah, build that next, yeah, next, even though the framing's all there. But yeah, you'd run these wild and chalk line it. And you would use a purple chalk line because there's other colors that are meant for other products like concrete or something else. So you don't want to use other colors because it could get into the surface and really have challenges getting it out.
So not remove as easily. So purple, yeah, you guys have found that for manufactured decking products in general, that comes off easiest.
Yeah, okay. So you'd snap a line. And like you say, the alternative is cutting one end, measuring, cutting, carrying over. So this way here, you actually drill it up, screw it all down, run a chalk line, take a circular saw and right, cut it. And this stuff, the workability is just great. I mean, your cut line is just smooth and accurate. Yeah. And even, you know, added to the best practice where it cuts so nice that it does have a good edge to it, you could even take it another step farther and route that and take that edge off.
Yeah. Well, great tips, Kev. I love that. So proper way to do a butt joint if you end up indeed having a butt joint. Clean cut in your ends, and a more efficient way to do that in potentially if you plan for picture framing and a transition board, things like that. So I love it.
Yeah. All right.
Thank you. Another good session.
Great. You're welcome. Thanks, Jim.